a website slash app called Canva. How many of us have ever heard of Canva? Yeah. So there's a lot of, that's great. I'm glad that makes my job a lot easier today. And so with Canva, I found that there's so many different things that you can use it for. The main thing that I use it for currently is just branding and building online content. And I've also used it recently for templates, making like cover photos, and also I did a Allstate masterclass where I just uploaded the pictures of the etudes, and you're able to draw and write comments and provide arrows and dynamics and all kinds of stuff that you would always have to handwrite and then copy scan. And then once it gets to the student and band director prints it off, it always doesn't look as clean as you want it. And with Canva, I was able to make these presentations or templates. And lastly, also building logos for yourself or for your company. It's an easy way. There's a free version and a pro version. The free version does pretty much anything you need it to. And then the pro version has a couple of extra things with templates. But the thing that I found easiest, and I feel like in my past life, I was a virtual designer or some kind of person who enjoys design. And I know that's not for everybody. Most of us are not, can't see that kind of thing. And so they have templates that makes it super easy for you to add pictures, and there's already built-in colors and everything. So it makes your job so much easier. And some content ideas, I think a lot of us struggle with I have one post that I think is really cool. And then we get to a couple weeks later, I'm like, I haven't posted anything in weeks. Maybe I need to get that going a little bit. And so I think for your studio, how many of us were studio professors or future studio professors? Awesome. I think we probably struggle with, what do I need to post in order to, A, make my students look great and to honor them and to share with the world of what our students are doing. I think that's really important for recruitment. I think it's important for the students to know that your studio is acknowledging them. I think it's great for parents too, for parents to see your child or their child's studio doing super well and enjoying their time. And so I included a couple of things that I think are really important for creating these content ideas. And so first and foremost, I think all concerts and studio recitals, you should be posting about those, right? There's they happen on a semi-regular basis, and that's super easy content. Snap a picture. Hey, congratulations on a great performance tonight. And if there's soloists from your ensemble or from your studio, acknowledge that. Competitions and awards, graduating students, showing the world that you are pushing out professionals into our world. Incoming students, honoring alumni spotlights. I think that's really important as well. Job placements, outreach events, guest master classes, and also fun studio gatherings. I think it's really great to kind of be a little informal as well. And for yourself as an artist or an emerging artist, doing posting about yourself in healthy ways of, and I'll show you after this some great examples. But for ourselves, posting when our auditions are for a studio teacher, I think it's really important to make a graphic of, here's my studio, here's my phone number, my email. I offer free lessons, free trial lessons, private lessons. If you're a private lesson teacher starting up a studio, I think it's great as well. Posting your recitals, your upcoming masterclasses or residencies, solo tour, upcoming performances, album release. So those are all quick, easy content ideas. And of course there's more, but I think this is a great starting point. And Drew and I were talking about, going back to, what if I'm not great with social media, right? There has to be somebody in your studio that is good at social media, right? This is kind of the day and age that we're living in. Everybody has an Instagram or TikTok in your studio. And growing up, I barely used Facebook and Instagram. And now it's like, now I have to have a TikTok. I don't know how that works. I currently don't have a TikTok, but I think those are relatable things for up-and-coming students as well. So creating a social chair to kind of head that up kind of takes the burden off of you as well. So Drew and I came up with, I think that's a really great point. And I wanted to share a couple of templates that you could probably use on your own. And I think it's perfectly okay if you, quote-unquote, steal other ideas. Like, why not, right? If you, like my favorite sports teams, I always look at their marketing and I check out like, oh, what are they doing with advertising of future events? And I always look at that and I'm just like, okay, I can do something like that. And so here's some great options. Like Seraph Brass, they're posting about their upcoming tour. And quick, easy read of who they are, what their name is, and what dates and locations they're touring. And so all of these content ideas, they aren't meant to be posted every day. They're meant to be shared. And that's how we get more views, right? So Seraph Brass posts one time on this, and you get hundreds of views, thousands of views and shares from friends and colleagues. And then you'll look at Martin McCain as well on the right side. This is super easy. I can tell he's going to have these residencies at Stetson with, you know, Marsalis at Cleveland Institute. Here's the days. Let me put these on my calendar. Let me share it with friends. And also, I really loved Ben Pierce's, his recital poster as well. This probably could be a Canva template. You just drag and drop a favorite picture and include your school's logo. Boom, you have a recital poster. How many of us have ever made a recital poster before? Yeah, a few of us, yeah. And I think it could be daunting, but with Canva, makes it super easy for you. Do we have any questions so far on any of this? No? Okay, great. Next, I want to talk a little bit about branding and color schemes. And believe it or not, your university or your organization has color schemes already built in. And through these colors, it's called hex colors or hex combinations, and you can just research it and has the official number of the color that you have for your school. And so at the bottom right, I have the U.S. Marines colors, and they have the primary colors, they have the secondary colors, and you can just copy and paste, and in Canva, go to the color changer, enter that color, boom, you already have your university colors, right? So if I was at Florida State, I would look up Florida State colors, go to their maroon and gold, copy, paste, and then I have the exact color, so I know that my brand is as close as possible with my own school. And so I do that all the time, and with Texas Lowbrass Academy, I have my certain color, and it was actually just a Canva light blue that I found. I was like, oh, this is cool, but I make sure I use it every time. And I would recommend using no more than two or three colors. You want something easy on the eye. You'll notice back here, Texas Bands, Anthony McGill, they use orange and white, and that's it. And you'll notice they bold certain letter or certain parts of the name. And the golden rule at the bottom, keep it simple, right? That's always kind of my goal. And I use simple fonts, try not to use, you know, more than one or two fonts. Sans serif, I think is a little bit easier on the eye, but you can also use serif font as well. And then consistency, go for simple layouts, like I said, using the fonts, colors, and logos that you always use. I think one common mistake is using, say, like a logo from the 1980s. Doesn't always look great or up to date, so you want to be on trend with using the right logos. And then the right verbiage as well, like keeping consistent branding verbiage as well. And lastly, Drew and I were going to kind of tag team this, but building an audience, I think this can be done in multiple ways. The first thing is I usually kind of save time and use like maybe an hour in the week of, okay, I want to put these posts out at certain times. On Facebook, there's like a business mode that you can schedule out posts, and that way, later in the week, if you are like, I'm really busy during that Thursday morning that I really want to post this thing, you can schedule a time, kind of like scheduling an email as well. And I think that's been really helpful for me. And also, if you have a deadline, say you have a registration deadline of January 21st, and you 2 weeks before that, you want to send out a post. Like, you might not 2 weeks before that, you might not be available to post exactly when you want to or forget. That's another great way of scheduling posts. And you'll want to kind of identify specific times that work best for your audience, right? Most of the time, you don't want to post on, you know, a Sunday morning, like super, super early, or Sunday night when everybody's asleep. Like, you want to try to find times that fit with your audience. And so Facebook and Instagram give you those times as well, and kind of gives you a good idea of when to post. And then lastly, hashtags and tagging. I've found that by creating things that involve students a lot really helps with that. So tagging the students so that they're sharing these ideas. Because if you post one thing that doesn't involve really anybody, there's probably not gonna get much traction, right? You wanna create something that is a group that celebrates somebody as well. And using the tags, they get more shares and views, and that's when the social media kind of takes over with algorithms. Drew, did you want to say anything else?
Yeah. So to both of these points, I think the first, along with the scheduling and the algorithm of it all, how your posts work is when you post, like, if I have a Facebook page for my Tuba-Euphonium studio, and we have 500 people that like our page. When you post something, it's not gonna push it out to all those 500 people all at once. It's gonna push it out to 25. And if some of those 25 people like it or interact with it somehow, they click on it, then it'll send it out to some more people and it'll be more people. And the more people that interact with that post, the more people will see it. So, you know, like there's kind of a hierarchy of, you know, a share is better than a like, then it's better than just a click. So, you know, if you have a lot of people sharing your posts, then more people are gonna see it, obviously. And then along with the hashtagging and tagging things, like when you post something, if you hashtag, you know, Tuba-Euphonium or Tuba-Euphonium or hashtag low brass, like you can be really creative with the words you're using, the verbiage you're using in order to reach more of an audience. Because if somebody's following the low brass hashtag, that might not follow the euphonium hashtag or just brass in general. Kind of the more general you can be with that kind of stuff, the more wider you're going to reach. So, yeah. Anything else on that? Any other questions on that? It's kind of confusing. You can Google like best times to post on Facebook or Instagram. It's generally like noon Eastern on Monday, Tuesday, and Friday or something like that. You know, you don't want to post, like Kevin said, at like Tuesday night at midnight. That's like the worst time to post because everyone's asleep. No one's going to be looking and sharing those things. So moving on, I'm going to talk about YouTube and TikTok, but really it's just video content of any kind. I like to make videos and I find that I'm not always great at it. So I have a love-hate relationship with it. But there's a couple things that are helpful when it comes to making video content. And this goes for anything, YouTube, TikTok, or Instagram videos, Facebook videos, anything that you're sharing online. So the logistics of making a video. The best camera that we all have is in our pockets, right? Specifically, this camera, the back camera. The front camera is fine, but it's not as high quality. So when you're making a video, you want to use that back camera. You can have, you know, if you have a fancy DSLR camera or something, you can use that, but it's totally not necessary. Every video that I've ever shot with my quartet, or, well, not everyone, but most of the videos I've shot with my quartet and all of my personal videos have been shot using whatever phone I have. So really simple. You can set your video settings to like 4K. Like that's above and beyond the quality that you're gonna need. The second thing you're gonna need is good sound equipment. So everyone during COVID obviously kind of upped their home studio sound equipment. Everybody's buying microphones. But what you have to do when you're recording a video is record your audio separately. So that means you record your video on your phone. I plug my USB mic into my computer and record using GarageBand or Audacity or Logic, whichever recording program you use. But you want to record it separately because there's not a good way to record video and audio together that's going to be the best high quality version of each. So highly, highly recommend recording your audio separate. And then when you go to edit the video, you can just put the audio right on top of it and it'll be lined up and everything. And then the last thing, and this is something that no one thinks about, but lighting is so important. The best lighting you can get is natural sunlight. So if you have a window in your office, set up your camera so that you're just looking directly out that window, because that's the best light you're going to get. Ring lights are okay, but they're really harsh. And so you can, a lot of times you can tell when people are using a ring light because it's like industrial grade light on their face, or like, especially with glasses, it's a huge problem. I hate using ring lights for that reason, because it's just like, every time you move your head, it's like a flash, right? So you can get, they're so-called soft boxes, and you know, find ways to diffuse that light to make it a little less harsh on your face. But you know, that's the most engaging part of your video, is what you look like. And so if you're kind of like half in shadow, talking, and like you're just using your phone sound, like no one's, you know, you're gonna watch it for 4 seconds and be like, I don't understand what they're saying, move on. So those are kind of like the logistics of making good video content. The next is the structure of your video. So, and kind of the editing software. So you can go a bunch of different directions with this. So I'll just kind of go over the basics, but do you want a beginner, like more user-friendly thing, or do you want some professional hefty software? And another thing to think about is, how much time do you want to invest learning that software? So if you have a beginner, you know, like Windows Movie Maker or iMovie on Macs, like those are very user-friendly, like easy to use, simple. There might be one or two YouTube tutorials you have to watch to like get some certain transition that you want to make, but generally pretty easy. Something like Final Cut Pro or Premiere Pro, those are very powerful video editing software that are can be extremely confusing to use. And I have spent hours, literal hours, watching YouTube tutorials on how to use these programs, especially if you're making something like a multi-track, you know, recording where you're getting recordings from 8 different people and you have to line them all up. It can get daunting and really kind of slow down your computer because they're using these huge video files and everything. So I would recommend starting with something like iMovie or Windows Movie Maker, that kind of stuff. So the stuff that already comes preloaded on your computer is 10 out of 10 easier to use. And then, so when you're making your video, you want to think about the structure of it. So as your runtime goes, you want to get a hook, right? You want something to let the viewer know what they're watching, what you're talking about. So you're saying, hey, my name is Drew Bonner, and I'm presenting at the United States Army Band Tuba-Euphonium Workshop this weekend. That's your hook. That's it. It should be short, succinct, and not like, you don't have to introduce yourself. You don't have to say, hey, how are you? I'm doing this with my life and blah, blah, blah. Like, no one cares about that as much as we want to believe that. But you want to get straight to the content as quickly as possible. So if you're going to make a video about double dunking, right, you're not going to start by saying, good afternoon, my name is Drew Bonner, I'm doing this, I do this, I compose music, I work on websites, blah, blah, blah. And by the time you get through your introduction, that person's gone. They're not watching that. So if you say, here's 10 tips for better double tonguing, good. Go right to the content. And the content should be like 80% of the video. So if you're talking about double tonguing, get right to the best thing first. And then maybe around number 5 out of 10 is like, eh, and then you want to end with something strong. And then when you get to the end, you call to action, which is you ask them to go to your website, you ask them to subscribe to your YouTube channel, you ask them to go check out your studio page, or even the best thing is you ask them to go watch another video, because that's going to get you more views, more shares. So the call to action is something that a lot of people forget to do. And even me in my own videos, I often forget, like, oh, I didn't record, like, hey, thanks for watching, and please go check out this other video if you like this one. It should be relatively short, just like the hook, but it should still be there. It's really, really important. And then the last thing about, like, structure and editing is filming yourself. Make sure that you're not putting yourself like on one side of the frame, put yourself in the middle. If you're filming for YouTube, put your phone this way. If you're filming for TikTok, put your phone this way. I will never forgive Gen X for like switching this on us. Like TikTok is like, now everybody films videos like this. And I'm like, oh, but I was, okay. Yeah, it's just crazy. So make sure that you're just, you know, filming correctly, and then speak clearly and concisely. If you have a script, study it. If you just want to use bullet points, that's also fine. But the main thing is that you just want to look directly into the camera. So often I see people that are, you know, looking, I don't know, where's the live stream camera? Right here. The camera's like, yeah, yeah, I see. And then they'll be like, hi, I'm doing this presentation. Okay, here we go. And I'm talking to you. I'm talking to you right there, right? It's like super, super obvious. And it's like totally unengaging when you aren't looking directly into the camera. It feels so weird when you're doing it, but it's super important. So look into the camera. And then last thing I want to touch on here is my idea of a good, better, best. So every video is going to have a good, better, best kind of hierarchy to it. My philosophy is that the good should be your equipment, right? Premium video equipment and cameras and fancy lighting and everything, that's nice, but not super necessary. If I could stand next to a window, done. So that's good. Better should be your filming and editing to make it engaging for the viewer as well as interesting to watch. Like if you can put in a little editing flare, a flash or something, and kind of refocus the viewer, that's going to help out your engagement. And then finally, the content should be the best. If you're giving a double tugging power lesson, that should be the thing that is forefront of the video and not like, you know, here's some flashy editing and some cool camera angles and whatever else. Like, there's a lot of people out there that make, especially like TikTok content that's like really flashy, but the advice is not good. So, there's also a lot of good people out there that make really flashy and really good videos. Subscribe to Drew Bonner Music. The golden rule is just start. I think it's really important to post about this stuff, to have a presence online. If someone Googles your name and nothing shows up, is that worse than having, you know, a website that's bad? I don't know. Like, so you need to have some kind of presence online, especially, you know, if you're interviewing for job positions or, you know, applying for literally anything. It's like, oh, I'm going to Google this person. Oh, there's nothing here. Or it's, you know, some YouTube page from 2012 that you uploaded your junior recital on or something, you know? And that's like, that's fine. Like, that content should be there, but that was then, you know? So, yeah. Here's some content ideas for videos. Obviously, like, recitals. That's like, you should be uploading something from your recitals. Masterclasses. If you're teaching a masterclass, put a camera in the corner and just, you know, that's like a really good opportunity. You don't even have to think about it. You just put the camera there and then go back and upload it. And that's like a free 20-minute lesson example for a potential student. Recording projects, music videos, if you're into that kind of stuff, like, I think every studio should be doing some kind of recording project in this day and age, like with your students, like ensemble, solos, quartets, chamber music, like getting them experience in the studio is really important. Excuse me. Any kind of special performances you have around campus, around the community, if you go and play Tuba Christmas, if you do a Tuba Ween or a Oktoberfest kind of stuff out in the community, those are all really great, really, really great. And then finally, sketches. This is kind of potentially controversial, but like, if you have some kind of like cute idea you want to do with your studio, make a video of them going to like the practice room and it's like a comedy something. I find Tuba-Euphonium players are generally pretty funny people. So show that, like, be yourself online. And then for soloists, for you, solo performances, making pedagogy videos about technique, practicing, literature, equipment, whatever, vlogs. So, you know, we're traveling here to the Army workshop for the weekend. Here's us on the plane. Here's us going to the exhibits, going to concerts, interviewing other musicians. You know, if you want to start a podcast, you know, make a video podcast. And then also, like, related topics. Like, I really love film music, so I'm a huge, huge film music nerd. So maybe I make a video about John Williams' score for whatever. Pop music, gigging. There's the options are literally limitless. And then also sketches, be funny. So final thing we're going to touch on here is websites. And basically, my philosophy on a website is you should have a website, and it should be a hub for all of your stuff. So you should be linking your Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, like TikTok, YouTube channel, whatever you have. It should all be a central hub so that when someone comes to your website, they can see every possible, you know, your studio page, your university page, whatever you have. They should be seeing every single place that you exist online. And yeah, Kev, you're going to take the rest.
Yeah, and going off of what Drew just said, especially if you are somebody who is like, oh, I don't know how to make a website. There are plenty of websites that can be built in for you. You know, Wix and Squarespace and what else am I missing? There's a bunch. But at least, you know, those two, there's templates already built. You know, secondly, hire somebody, right? Hire a professional to do it and make it look really good. And I'm not a professional on that. But, you know, there's a lot of people that kind of dabble in website building, people that do it for their career. And so, you know, if I was hiring somebody for a wedding gig, it's like I would hire a professional musician to do that, to do a good job and to represent my event. I think that you should do that for your website, especially if you are in that part of your career where you need a website, applying for jobs, and promoting yourself, that and what Drew said, linking everything to and from your website. And I kind of made a list of kind of the must-haves that I feel like you should have on your website, and professional pictures. Also, you know, those don't have to be professional in terms of a professional photographer taking them. I think it's really great to have that. I would suggest that. But like Drew said, there's also a really great camera on your phone. Right. I think if you have an iPhone 9 or above, you have the portrait mode, and you can use that and make it look good or good enough. And having multiple pictures with your instrument, without your instrument, having fun, like showing your true character. You know, you should have pictures of you smiling, not just all serious on your website. I don't know if I'd want to study with somebody that's like super serious all the time. You know, some people might, but for me, I want to have fun in lessons and in music. So show yourself, show your personality within those pictures. And secondly, have a bio, make sure, and I know Drew can get on his soapbox about composers having their birth date and a birth year. You know, make sure if you're a composer, have your birth year so you don't have to track them down. And this ties into a contact page. If you have a contact page, make sure it's the right email that you use quite frequently, and have a portion on your website that has a contact page. Those are really easy to make, or have your email address. I would recommend having a contact page because you get a lot of spam emails if you just have your email on the website. And lastly, on the must-haves, I think Jarret McCourt just made a new website for David Zirkle, my teacher at Michigan, and he has, I think, a really great portion on his website. It has studio links, so it has come study with me. Here's the links to the School of Music. Here's the links to the university. You know, here's links to X, Y, and Z. I think that's an amazing thing to have, links to lessons and how to set up those lessons for prospective studio members. And so I would, if especially if you're a college teacher or incoming college teacher pursuing that, you should totally have that on there. I think it's fantastic. And optional things, I think having your services, right? Especially like in the music world, if you're dabbling in multiple things, you can say, hey, I play Tuba-Euphonium. I also run websites. I also do this and this and this, and I can be an adjudicator. I love doing solo and ensemble and teaching private lessons. I think all those services to make you more marketable and to know that when somebody is contacting you, they can see, oh, Drew does all this stuff. I didn't realize he's also a fantastic euphonium player, but also can do all this composing and stuff that I can't do. So I think it's great to have that. Next is resources. If you're a music educator and providing resources for festivals, for the list goes on and on for instruments and music companies, those are also great. We mentioned social media links and also recordings. I think this is kind of like a controversial optional thing. I almost would have that as a must-have, especially if you're applying for jobs, having recordings right away. And good recordings that represent your best playing within the past probably year or two. And like Drew mentioned, like you probably don't want to have your junior recital on there. And also it's good, especially if you're still in school, like using the resources at school to make quality recordings, or if you're an institution that provide you those opportunities, make it a goal, you know, every semester, every other semester, to have at least one or two recordings that you're getting good recording or audio for, and possibly video as well. Like Drew mentioned, super easy to set up a camera and to just have that. We're gonna go on to any questions. What time is it? We have still have quite a bit. So we were gonna open the floor up. If anybody has any questions about any of the topics that we discussed or anything else, really. Drew and I aren't, you know, professionals at this, but we it's something that we're passionate about and want to help others, especially if there's a part of this that you don't understand or want to know more about. Yeah, in the back.
I was just wondering, for something like resources, how to draw the line of, like, if you have like a special warm up or something and you put the whole warm up up, then some people won't come see you for that warm up.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess, like, how do you give them the taste without giving them everything and still, like, how do you get more work through it rather than put yourself out of work? And same thing with, like, video content. I struggle with, because there's so much on, you know, YouTube, and there's so many personal trainers and fitness people that are up that kind of do that. They put up this whole workout series, and then who's going to come to them for it if they can get it for free sometimes? So I wonder that balance. So I'm just wondering your both of your takes on balancing the resources that you provide for free versus, you know, doing it for a career and getting paid to do
definitely.
It.
Definitely. Yeah, I think, know. Yeah, Drew can probably talk about this for 20 minutes.
Well, yeah, I think, honestly, viewing them as two completely separate things. Like, if you're going to come and study with me long term, that's one thing. But if you're going to consume my content, that's another thing. So, obviously, this one is going to inform this one, but this one is more trying to reach them kind of where they're at. And then this is, if you liked that, check this out, you know? But if you're going to make a 40-page warm-up packet, like, that's a book, you know, like that, you could publish that, right? And it's like, do I want to put that on my website for free? I don't know. But I think maybe you could creatively structure it so that you could post the first chapter or something, you know, the first set for free. And then, you know, it's like, okay, if you like that, you can go, you know, go to my store and purchase it for $10 or something, whatever it is. But yeah, really trying to separate the two kind of parts of this relationship, because your online content is like, it serves a purpose, not only to like inform people and teach them everything, but it's to get your name out there and to, you know, be a known entity, a known quantity in the community that you're trying to be a part of, whether it's Tuba-Euphonium or, you know, whatever, coffee making.
I also have another thing.
Yeah.
I also think there's this way of, Drew was talking about video editing, right? And incorporating maybe one part of the warm-up within that video. You know, maybe it's a short video. Maybe you go through it with them, so, and you play it. Okay, now we're gonna play it together, adding in a little bit extra time with that, and say, okay, now that you know this part of our warm-up, I'm gonna take you to this PDF that you can purchase on my website to kind of get the ball rolling a little bit more on that, you know. But I understand, it's like, okay, I wanna push out this content, but we still have to pay our bills, right? So, great question, thank you. Yeah, anything else? Yeah, Chris.
Yeah, I was just curious what you guys think about like a quantity versus quality kind of debate. Like, every time I think about like starting to post on Instagram or something like that, I like listen back to the video being planned, I'm like, maybe if I hear it, somebody else will hear, you know, what I don't like about playing or whatever.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's a kind of a very controversial, I think, right? You know, because there's a lot of, there's a lot of practice channels now on Instagram, and you know, those are like more of, okay, I'm gonna put everything out there that I'm working on, right? And then there's accounts where it's like, okay, I'm only gonna put the finished 100% final product on there. And to me, I think there can be this balance of like, okay, well, let me post what I'm working on right now and show this timeline of the final product, right? And that's showing, you know, that's you being vulnerable, but that's also showing people that you're human and you make mistakes and that you're working towards this goal of making a piece really, you know, spectacular. And then also, I think, you know, going back to the kind of the branding idea of, okay, I'm gonna post my solo tour or guest artist masterclass tour or something. That, you know, you only have to post that really one time, right? And if you get some traction on it, shares, that's gonna really help. And then maybe, you know, a couple weeks later, you get close to the event, you're gonna share it again or post a similar idea. And so that kind of creates this like, okay, I'm not really like posting about my masterclass, you know, at, you know, random university college in the US every single day, but I'm reminding people, okay, if you're in this area, like, I'd love to see you. And I have this graphic that people will want to share instead of, you know, just posting like a kind of a boring Facebook status that is like, okay, nobody's going to really share this and I'm going to be talking about it and nobody's going to really see it. Does that kind of answer that? Do you have anything else?
I think also kind of Kevin's point, like especially during like the pandemic when we were all kind of making videos, the level of expected accuracy and like artistry for videos went through the roof because we're like, oh, everyone's at home now. Everyone has to learn how to, you know, make everything perfect. Or I'm recording this video audition. Oh, I fracked the fourth note, so let me just start over. Like, so I think we have to recalibrate our consumption and, you know, creation of those kinds of things to just be like, hey, I'm working on this music just like you. Like, you know, I may be a great sight reader, but I'm not a good X or, you know, whatever. So trying to post that and like, you know, be human, you know, like I'm a musician working hard just like everybody else. Like, you know, I can't sight read the Cosma, you know, and being vulnerable, like Kevin said, in that sense, I think is really important and kind of speaks to your humanity more than superficial, like, oh, here's a super clean recording of, you know, Carnival of Venice. Like, okay, I've seen that a million times, you know. So any other questions? Yeah.
Too specific, but when I'm trying to make posters on Canva, sometimes I find it very difficult to find a good template. Do you have any suggestions for what to search to find good templates on the free version?
Part of that might be is because it's on the free version. The pro version has a lot more template ideas and help in that regard. Was it like for a solo masterclass or mainly solo performance?
Recital posters, masterclass, advertisement, yeah. Whatnot, all of the above, really.
Yeah, I've found that looking at, because there's different parts of Canva. You can like look in flyers as well. Those are really great. Or, like I mentioned earlier, just borrowing other people's ideas. You know, you see, like if you see a great recital poster, like it's okay to kind of steal the idea of that, you know. I would just say that there's ways of, you know, inserting a grid where you can like upload a picture in it as well and kind of make your template. You can add lines or different colors as well. So that would be my, if you were on the free version, that would be my best probably advice for that. Or asking somebody that has the pro version to help you out, and I'd be happy to. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah, Keith.
What are your thoughts on the frequency? And maybe of the content in that, you know, how many times you're posting, because I keep posting the same picture of my Tuba on Instagram and it's doing great.
Yeah, no, I think, yeah, well, I think we run into this thing of like, I feel like Instagram, I feel like it has a better traction of being able to post more stuff. Do you feel like you have the same, you post the same content on Facebook, or do you mainly just do Instagram?
I don't really do Facebook too much.
Okay.
Because
Yeah, exactly, right? And I think we have to play into the students, right? Where you're, like in your case, you're trying to recruit students, and most students right now are not on Facebook and are on Instagram, TikTok, Twitter. And so I think the more that you're, if people are interacting with it, that means you're doing something right. And I would just keep doing it. And yeah. Yeah, exactly. Daily Tuba posts.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, just, you know, Instagram, like you could post the same picture and like, I'll, like people would question like, oh, I thought I liked this. And then like, again, you know, like I do that all the time. And that's like a cheat code. But like other platforms like YouTube, like you could post one video every 6 months and like that would be totally fine, you know? Or like TikTok is like the Wild West, man. It's like you could post a video and it could get, you know, 300,000 views. Like, and it's just like, oh, here's the Star Wars theme, you know? And it's like every kid is like, oh my God, like you sound incredible. And it's like, I recorded this like in 2 minutes, like, you know, it's fine. But like, TikTok is like really, really, really like powerful if you're trying to like grow as a creator. Like it is, you, especially in the past year, like, you know, you could just post a couple things like, and if as you get in that kind of rhythm of posting, it's like, oh, I make a video every day and it takes me 15 minutes. Like that's good. Like, and that really rewards that kind of cyclical kind of posting cycle, whereas like Instagram and Facebook, all that stuff doesn't really. But it also kind of, if you take, like I took a while off of TikTok and like came back recently-ish and like posted a video and it got like hardly like 1% of the views that I used to get. So that's kind of like volatile in that way. So, because once you get into that cycle, then you're just like thinking about it constantly and you're just like, I have other things to do in my life. But yeah, so anyway, that's my thoughts on TikTok and all that stuff. Oh, my computer fell asleep.
Beyond this presentation, where do you guys learn what's good, what were good resources, bad resources?
Yeah, for me, YouTube, like tutorials on, you know, if you Google or search on YouTube, like best video practices or best time to post or watching a, you know, how to edit things on Canva or whatever, like that's the thing that helps me the most. So very specific questions, you can find a YouTube video for anything.
Are there any? Right. Anybody can post. And some people know more, and some people make up stuff more. Do you have any reliable sources? The people you, you go to.
As like, how do you mean? Sorry, like as like inspiration or like people who like post well.
I mean, people that have credible information as opposed to the crackpot that's just something up.
I'm not really sure about like specific like people or channels to look into. There's a channel that I like called Think Media. It's a YouTube channel, but they make like, you know, they have like reviews of the best cameras to use and stuff like that. Information-wise, I'm not sure. Kev?
A lot of it is kind of me messing around with what works and what doesn't. Like since I'm kind of the graphic designer for my organization since the inception. And looking back on things, I was like, oh, wow, that really wasn't very good. So a lot. And then to now, I'm like, oh, yeah, we've grown a lot, you know, as a kind of a virtual thinker and all that. But so a lot of it is just kind of guess and check and see what works and kind of get your own. Specifically, were you thinking like videos or Instagram posts or anything? Yeah. Yeah, I mean, well.
You picked the wrong person to start, and, you know, you go off the beaten trail.
Yeah, you know, in a way, like, this is kind of new for, you know, recruitment and advertising. And I would, if you're in a university, there's probably a marketing person as well that you can reach out to. That might be a really great starting point. As far as online resources, I honestly kind of just, like I mentioned earlier, go to organizations or like my favorite sports teams and see what they do and just try to mimic it on my own. And so I, maybe Drew and I can try to see if we can find some names for you. Personally, I don't have any other than like maybe YouTube people.
Yeah.
But yeah, we can try to search on some names, but great question. Yeah. In the back.
Do you know of Gary V. Vaynerchuk?
Yeah.
VaynerMedia?
Yeah.
That's a great, I mean, he does a lot of random content, so you have to search through it for this specific stuff, but
cool.
I feel like he figured it all out. I mean, he was doing YouTube videos before anybody. He was doing, he started out like selling wines and stuff, but now he runs like a media company where he does this for athletes and all that. But I mean, and I'm from New Jersey. He's from Jersey. There's part of that Jersey attitude. So he swears a bit, and like talks and all that. But anyway, I think he's a great place to start. And I didn't know.
Yeah.
We were coming up with any names. I hope it's
appreciate
okay
it.
That I just said.
Yeah, and also somebody in our community, Scott Sutherland, has really fantastic stuff. And he's answered questions for us regarding recording and, you know, how to record, editing. Yeah, I mean, he's fantastic. And the way he just put out a new, I think his students were doing a recruitment tour. Fantastic. Short videos, right to the point. And I think within 24 or 48 hours, they booked their whole tour because people were sharing it. People saw the quality that it was. And I think it's fantastic. So he would be a great resource in California. So any other questions? I think we're pretty close to out of time. So yeah, thanks Zach and Pershing. Thanks for having us. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Whoa, hot mic. All right. Maybe I'm just projecting a little too much. All right. So welcome, and just a few announcements before we get on to this next performance. Our program is online, so if you have any questions about what's going on and what to expect the rest of today and tomorrow, please go to usarmyband.com. Please tag us on Instagram. It's at usarmyband. That always helps helps with the algorithm, as you know. AFTI is today at 1615. If you know what that is, then you should probably be an AFTI. The exhibits are open right now, but please don't leave. So, but check it out after this recital. They're open until 5:30 today, and then they're open tomorrow at 10 o'clock until 5:30. So lots of time to pick your spots to go try out some horns. And lastly, please register for the workshop on the Eventbrite link. You can find that on our website as well, usarmyband.com. All right. So our next performer is the professor of tuba and euphonium at the University of Northern Iowa. Please help me welcome Dr. Stephanie Ycaza.
Thank you. That's my best Portuguese pronunciation. My studio at UNI was part of the commission for that piece. Fernando was kind enough to make versions for euphonium, bass tuba, and contrabass tuba. And I believe the exclusivity for that piece ends in March. So if you want to get a hold of it, I would recommend it. The next set of pieces that we're going to play for you come from duets written by Zoe Cutler. Zoe Cutler is a Detroit-based trombonist and composer. So these duets come from a set called 20 Tricky Tunes for Two Trombones. You'll notice that we have zero trombones, but I really like this. I have now played them with trumpet, with bassoon, with Zoe's approval, and now with euphonium, which I could say is much more comfortable. But I would encourage you to check these out as well. The first one's called Impulse, The second one is called Sunny. The third one is called Klezmer. And I am really pleased to be joined by my college professor, Dr. Ross Walter from Virginia Commonwealth University.
Thank you.
For the final piece on the program, the live stream will be able to hear me a little bit better, hopefully. Once again, I want to thank everybody for coming out this afternoon. I'd like to thank Dr. Walter, Nick, my accompanist, Brian, who's running sound for us today, and everybody here at the workshop for making this such a great experience year after year. The final piece I'll play for you today is two movements from Evan Ziegel's Concerto for Tuba and Heavy Metal. Hopefully you know of this piece. If not, I would definitely recommend checking it out and other things that Evan has written. It is a ton of fun to play. I'm going to play just movement two, start with movement two, and then finish with movement one.
Thank you.
Everybody get some good headbanging in right there? Okay, so before I announce our next artist, I do want to draw some attention to our very own pianist who has been helping us out this week, Staff Sergeant Nick Starr. Nick has filled in for one of our accompanists who unfortunately could not make it. And so we as the committee and I'm sure all of us here as Tuba-Euphonium players thank him and our other accompanist, Ina, for helping this entire workshop go in the absence of a couple of accompanists. So our next artist, probably doesn't need an introduction, is the principal tubist with the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra. Please help me welcome Mr. Tim Buzbee.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for coming. I'm Tim Buzbee, and that first piece was Bach's flute sonata in E flat. You got to hear the more girthy version, which I prefer. I'm sure you do too, considering we're at a Tuba-Euphonium workshop. So hope I didn't make too many flute players in the audience mad. In fact, I hope there's none here. Anyways, joking. Continuing with the theme of beg, borrowing, stealing, and ripping off. This next piece is another one. Any trombone players in the audience? Well, you're going to love this then. So this is The Romance from Webern, and Martin McCain from the University of Texas arranged this, and it's a very, very nice little arrangement, and it works very well on bass trombone and obviously on its original instrument, the tenor trombone. The thing is, my wife's a incredible trombone player, and I've heard her play this piece like a million times, and I always think, man, I wish I could play something like that. It's so pretty. And also, all the students at the university I teach at during juries and recitals, they play this all the time also, and I always think, man, I could play it better than that. So anyway, so with all that said, I'm going to hopefully not put my foot in my mouth on this. So this is The Romance. Hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
So, as you all probably have heard, there was a bit of some scrambling going on a few days ago, or I can't remember. Everything's a blur at the moment, but it's been a long half week already. So, but anywho, I found out that the first pianist broke his wrist, and I was like, yeah, no problem. Okay, they've sorted me a new one. That's fine. And then, like 10 minutes before the rehearsal yesterday, the other one also had an issue. So I really appreciate, you know, the quick response. And man, fantastic piano player, you know, which is always makes my life a lot easier. So because of all that, though, I changed the program, and so I had to find something to finish the concert for you guys. And so I decided to just play a little six-pack medley, so it won't be all six-pack, but it'll be maybe three of them. I can't remember. I'll see you when I get over there. So anyways, I hope you like it, and thanks again. And man, this is always such an honor and pleasure to come to the Army Band and play with the band, and these guys are the salt of the earth. All of them treats me very well, and I have nothing but big praise for this festival, this workshop, and I hope it continues for another 1,000 years. So anyways, thank you again.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. My name is Staff Sergeant Mark Placencia. I am one of the newest members of the ceremonial tuba section here. It's so exciting to be a part of this workshop from the other side. I was here in the last live one in 2020, so it's been so fun serving you and making this possible for all of you. A couple of announcements. I'm sure you've heard this a lot, but the program is online. Scan the QR codes that you see around. There's also some physical programs outside that you can reference as well. Please tag us on Instagram at US Army Band. One of the ways that we're able to keep this happening is if the Army knows that we're making an impact, and that's one of the ways that we're able to do that. Another way that the Army can know that we're making an impact is by registering for the workshop, just so that we can keep account of people who are attending. For armed service members, the AFDI rehearsal today is at 4:15, and exhibits are open today until 5:30. So I'm very honored to introduce Jarret McCourt and his lecture on self-care. He is currently teaching at Vanderbilt University. He also works with the Crisis Text Line and is a yoga instructor. He has given this talk at over 20 universities, and I think anybody who's pursued music professionally has needed to take care of themselves and had moments where their mental health maybe has suffered a little bit. I think this is an extremely important topic for all of you to hear, and I'm so happy that you are here. Please, everybody, give a hand for Jarret McCourt.
Thanks, Mark, and thank you all for coming to this. It's sort of a little tuba, I hope. Mark introduced me, and I'll introduce myself in a little bit more detail in a couple of minutes, but this talk is about self-care and mental health. And I will go into sort of the specifics about that again when I introduce myself, but I always like to start with this little GIF or meme or whatever you call it. Oh, did I go back? Ah. So there is this idea about grind culture and working hard to work hard. And oftentimes that's something that is pushed in the music world. And I like this because I really like dogs, and I just got a dog. And a big motivating factor for me sometimes is, what am I practicing for and why am I practicing? And sometimes we practice, of course, for a performance, or we practice for a recital or what have you. But having an end goal in mind that is not attached to an actual goal, that we are seeking to have something for another living thing, always motivates me. And I want to give my dog a really nice backyard one day. So that's what puts me in the practice room nowadays. And I hope that you can also have a backyard for your dog in your practice. So a little bit about me. As you heard, I am primarily a tuba player and tuba teacher. I teach at Vanderbilt University. Right now, I play in the Ann Arbor Symphony and Santa Fe Opera. And I, of course, love playing the tuba, but I love to do also many other things. I design websites. Some of you may know this guy. He teaches at the University of Michigan. And I, during the pandemic, took a coding boot camp and just got really into designing websites. And for me, it's a great use of my creative skills and also my interpersonal abilities. And as you can probably tell by now, I get bored when I just do one thing. So doing multiple things really sort of fills up my cup. I'm a runner. I ran the Chicago Marathon this year. That was my third marathon, and a couple half marathons before that. I take pictures and travel. I am a yoga teacher. This is me doing a handstand in Switzerland. So the combination of two of those things. And as Mark also said, I work for a great organization called Crisis Text Line. And Crisis Text Line is a service that you or anyone you know can take advantage of if you are in crisis or in anxiety or having a panic attack and you need to talk to somebody. And this is a great intervention place where you can seek out any kind of help in the moment if you don't have someone who you can reach out to, or if you know someone who needs help, or if you have a friend who you don't know how to communicate with. It's a great line to speak with. And I'll talk about that a little bit later as well. But the main part of this presentation is talking about how we can stay on top of things in our life so that everything seems a little bit more manageable. And this part of the presentation will perhaps seem not very revolutionary to some of you, but really what the revolution is when you actually implement these things. Because so many of us, I think, especially when we're in the grind and we're doing the thing, we forget to check in with ourselves and we start to lean into bad habits or not listen to our bodies, and we stay up really late watching Netflix or practice too long or practice mindlessly, and it doesn't actually do anything productive for us. So a big part of this is awareness. So I'll probably try to move through this first part fairly quickly. And then the second part is really five things that I've learned while working for Crisis Text Line that I use with people that I communicate with to help them in the moment when they're experiencing anxiety. And this is helpful for, of course, anyone who experiences anxiety, or if you are a teacher who has students who experience anxiety, or if you have neighbors or friends or colleagues or anyone who's ever in this space. These are just tangible things that we can do that can help us in the moment. So for the first part, again, these kind of things that we can do during our day to make things more manageable. The first thing is just to make a list. I start every day with just making a list of the things that I need to do. And sometimes when I need a win, there are things like take a shower or brush my teeth. And there's little things, of course, that don't take a lot of effort, but sometimes just the idea and the act of marking something off of our list is in and of itself a win. And sometimes we need a win more than other times. Having a morning routine, something that we can show up for ourselves every day, is really helpful and impactful, especially just this idea of doing the same thing repetitively. A big part of my morning routine is, of course, doing something physical and doing something, you could say, spiritual or mentally fulfilling. So physical, you know, I'll go for a walk with my dog, I'll run, do yoga or something. And then the spiritual side can be something like meditation or even just sitting quietly and just trying to just be with your thoughts for a second. A lot of our day is just spent thinking about what we need to do next or something that happened yesterday. And so little time is actually spent thinking about this slice of time that we are living in right now. So anything that you can do to just sort of be mindful of that current moment and that sort of spiritual side, of course, the spirituality is a different discussion that is a broader topic. It doesn't have to be, you know, for you can be praying or anything like that, but can be as simple as just sitting and being mindful of the present moment. With regards to music, because we are all musicians in here or music enthusiasts, I think bringing this mindfulness is very important to our practice sessions. And what better way to do that than to take ownership of our practice sessions by recording everything we do? And this is a big thing that I try to hit home with my students, in that I'm a firm believer of the fact that when you are practicing and playing something, especially if it's not a whole note, if it's technical to any level, it's very difficult to actually do the thing at a very high level and listen to the thing at a very high level. So recording yourself and then making time to listen back to that is critical to improve. And not only critical to improve, but it will also be the thing probably that separates you from other people who do not do this. So I think there's, again, as I mentioned before, there isn't a whole lot of revolution to the things that I'm saying. Of course, I'm sure that you've had teachers and friends and colleagues who have been saying these things for years, but there are actually, in my opinion, very few people who integrate these things into their lives or their practice sessions or their teaching. So just take time to try to work these things into your life and your music making. Goal setting, obviously a big part of being mindful too. So the idea that we have different types of goals, I think, just orients us towards what we want most in our days, our weeks, and our lives. With regards to micro goals, I'm thinking, what can I do today? Sort of in that list idea. What are the things that I can get done with my energy that I have today while I am awake? The medium goals, sort of what can I work towards over a finite amount of time? For me right now, this is Duolingo. How many hours a day or how many minutes a day can I put towards learning German? So possibly the next time that I'm forced to know German, that I actually know German. I was just a bit of context about that. I recently had to play with a German orchestra with about 3 weeks notice, and all the rehearsals were in German, and you never know what opportunity is going to come to you. So it's best to be prepared for those things by goal setting. The next one is just this macro goal. So just having an idea of where you want to go, and I'm sure teachers do this with their students, teachers do this with themselves, but a big part of macro goal setting, I think, should be the idea that we should have goals that resonate with us. And if you are working towards, for example, getting a job because your teacher might tell you that you need to be working towards getting a job, I don't know if you'll actually work towards that with all of yourself every day. So a big part, again, of this macro goal setting is sitting down and saying, okay, well, what do I want long-term? What do I want in 1 year? What do I want in 5 years? What do I want in 10 years? And again, just this mindfulness of where we see ourselves and where we want to see ourselves is critical. And as I mentioned with the list thing, this idea that we can look back on these goals and say, wow, I actually did a lot over the last month or year. And there've been a lot of times when, you know, September, October rolls around, almost a whole calendar year, and I've looked back at my lists and I'm like, wow, I actually did a lot of that stuff. And having that list and that accountability for ourselves is critical to being able to move through things with any kind of optimism, at least in my opinion. This idea of taking advantage of resources is important. If you're a student, most likely your university has access to, or institutional access to, great resources that you won't have when you leave a school. So taking advantage of those things like Berlin Digital Concert Hall, music libraries, Naxos, what have you, this is very important to have access to, because you won't have access to that forever. And you know, if you are working towards a professional playing goal, I had a big change in my practice sessions when I started to turn my phone on airplane mode. And this was something that somebody told me that I was like, oh yeah, well, whatever. I focus fine in my practice sessions. But the minute I started doing that, and the minute that I made practicing sort of my dojo and this mindful time that I spent actually physically thinking about getting better and mentally fully engaged, it was exhausting. Because it's a full mental and physical workout to actually practice your instrument. And that's when I started to see marked improvement and quick improvement on things that I was setting out to do on a short term. So very important to do that. And I think it's just worth it to do that. If you want to do this, I think you should put all of yourself into this. And a big part of this is trying to eliminate distractions, because the phone is distracting, as I'm sure you all know. This is really, really big. This idea of being deliberate with the time that we are working and the time that we're not working. And specifically with the time that we are not working, I think so many of us, especially music students who are working towards these professional goals, grad schools, whatever, we wake up, we spend some time practicing, we're in classes all day, we're working, and then we spend a bunch of hours practicing at night. There's no boundaries there. I mean, you're literally working from the minute you wake up to the minute you go to bed, and then we're expected to wake up the next day and have a full battery. That's not sustainable. And that's why I think this idea of burnout culture is becoming prevalent, because so many of us are spending all of our on time on, and there is no time that's being allotted for being off. It's critical. So I recommend starting with a 9-to-5 system if you can. I mean, if you don't have any kind of, you know, if you're a student and you have classes in those hours, that's fine. Those times can move around, but just having a little bit of time, even at the end of your day, that you can dedicate to just doing something that is designated for self-care. And this is, of course, the topic of this seminar. But if you're thinking about self-care, and if you're thinking about the things that actually nourish you and the things that charge your battery and the things that make you want to wake up the next day and get back in the practice room or get back in the classroom or get back in the workspace, that's probably a very personal thing, this idea of self-care. And what is self-care for me? As I mentioned earlier, yoga, running, playing with my dog. What's self-care for you? Probably very different. Maybe knitting or watching a movie or playing video games and spending time being mindful about what we are actually using for self-care is critical, and not saying, there's this thing in yoga teaching, you know, a lot of yoga teachers or people who do yoga are like, you should just do yoga. And it's like, well, yoga is not the key to everyone's problems. Yoga or physical activity might work for some people, but it certainly does not work for everyone. And this also, I mean, even smaller in regards to physical activity, if you're looking to get on any kind of physical activity train and you're not sort of resonating with running or Peloton or weightlifting, there's probably something out there that you actually enjoy and can commit to. So keep that in mind when you're thinking about any kind of self-care or physical activity. And then this idea of diversifying yourself, very, very important. And I try to push this home with my students all the time, in that there was a moment when I was in my master's where I was spending so much time practicing, I went to a party with a bunch of other grad students, and I had only been thinking about Ride of the Valkyries for like 3 days. And I couldn't talk about anything but Ride of the Valkyries. And I don't want you to be that person who's at a party who doesn't have anything else to talk about besides Ride of the Valkyries. So think about things that you can do off of your instrument. I feel like I have several, and sometimes I want to do different things on different days, and that just gives me different things to talk about. Right now I'm really into cocktail making, so if any of you want to talk about booze or making cocktails, please, I would love to talk about that. But this idea that spending 10 minutes on an activity every day to make us a more well-rounded and a person who can communicate easier and can communicate things that we like easier is just really important to being an interesting person. And people, I think, inherently want to be around interesting people. So think about that. Again, the second part of this presentation is just about this idea of how can we go from hot to cool. This is the idea that we try to hit home on the crisis text line. And that a hot moment is one where you are filled with so much anxiety and just thought about something that is bothering you that you can't think about anything else. And that is, in my opinion, a 10 out of 10 hot moment. So what can we do in the moment to go from that moment to a moment where we can actually handle the thing that we are being hot about? And a big part of this, well, actually, let me talk about crisis text line for a second, because I said I was going to. Crisis text line, there we go. Crisis text line is a service that you can text into at any time by texting 686-868 and be communicated with, or be connected with someone rather, who has been trained for 40 hours to talk to anyone who is in a state of anxiety or panic. I will be the first person to say that this is not a replacement for therapy, or it's not a replacement for any kind of long-term sustainable solution to mental health issues. But if you or someone you know is in a situation where you have nowhere else to turn and you need to talk to somebody, this is a great place to turn. It's, you know, you could say that it's a last resort, but I think it's a great resource to have. Now, as a yoga teacher, mindfulness and meditation is a big part of how I stay mentally healthy. And one of the things that I try to say in this topic, and just whenever I'm talking about this with my students or my friends or family or colleagues, is that the people who are the happiest, I believe to be not a person or group of people with an absence of mental health issues, but they're the people who have the most tools to deal with these things. And I don't think anyone can actually say that they can run their whole life without at any point feeling any form of anxiety. I think anxiety shows up in different, you know, ways for different people, but to be able to say that you don't worry about anything on some level, that is amazing. And I think you should be teaching this class if that's you. But this idea that we all need somewhere to go if we are feeling any kind of panic is very important. And mindfulness, meditation, is a big part of this and being able to ground ourselves in the present. This slice of time, whenever I say the word now, it's one word, it's very quick. But so many of us, like I mentioned before, spend so much of our day thinking about something that happened yesterday that stressed us out, or something that's coming up that's stressing us out. And this moment, because it's so small, is inherently not stressful. What is in this moment? Nothing. It's already in the past. So anything you can do to ground yourself in the moment, breathing is a big part of this. But the best advice that I ever got about meditation came from a very well-known tuba player by the name of Warren Deck. And Warren Deck is a god of tuba playing and tuba teaching, but he's also a mindfulness guru. He gave me a great metaphor one day when we were in the middle of a lesson, and he said, you know, meditation for me is not about sitting in a room with the lights off, candles, and yoga clothes. It's just about this idea where you can think about being next to a river, for example, and there being a leaf sort of pass you by. You pick up the leaf, you examine it, you sort of look at its color and texture, and then you put it back into the river and you let it float away. And that is how we should interact with our thoughts while we are meditating. There is this misconception about meditation that we need to have an absence of thoughts when we're meditating. And I'm sorry to break it to you, but unless you are an enlightened Buddhist monk, I don't think you're going to be able to do this for longer than about 5 seconds. So I would say that this idea of closing your eyes, connecting with the breath, and if you have a thought come in, have patience and understanding for yourself, interact with the thought, ask yourself how it feels, good or bad, something very simple, and then let it float away. And this mindfulness in the moment is a muscle that we exercise so that when you are feeling hot in the moment, you can take this moment and interact with it and then let it float away. It's a very important skill that I feel like meditation, again, is this thing that people think that they're in a room and they're thinking about nothing, but in reality, it's this skill and this muscle that we need to exercise. So we're going to do a little exercise. And for 3 minutes, we are just going to breathe, and I'm going to take you through something very similar to what I do in a yoga class. If any of you have ever done yoga before, you don't need to stand up or do any kind of up dog, down dog, anything like that. But this is just breathing, And I will keep an eye on the time, but I want you to start by first fixing your gaze at a point somewhere on this wall. You're all facing this way. Just look at something. Maybe this cord up here, maybe the piano here, and start to breathe in a very unmetronomic way. And when you feel good, close your eyes. When you're breathing, feel the lungs expand and come back. If it helps you to focus on the breath, you can count at the top of the inhale. 1, 2, and at the bottom. And then just for a moment, focus your energy to the top of your head, right where the crown would be. And think about drawing a line from the top of your head down your face, past your neck, down your chest, past your hips, down your leg, and land on your feet. And wiggle all 10 toes. And then draw that line back up from your shin, past your knees, past your hips, up past your chest, and place it on your head. And I'm going to count down from three, and when I get to zero, I want you to feel like you're at the deepest point of this breath, that the breath at zero is the most relaxed breath you've ever taken, that every number you're stepping deeper, deeper into a relaxed breath. Three. Two. One. And zero. And open your eyes. So that was 120 seconds. You have a several amount of those groups of time during your day that you can do exactly what we just did. Just out of curiosity, how many people in the room have meditated before in some form? Lots of you. Okay. What was that like for you guys? Just physical sensations? What were you thinking about? Anything? Wes, pick on you.
So you stopped me. I knew you were going to pick. I'm having a lot of tension issues, and I felt like I was able to kind of pinpoint where, like exactly where, like specific muscle spots and stuff during it, but also like just through the breathing relaxed. So that's where I'm at, like right now. It was very physical, but the mental was on the physical. Like I was able to concentrate without external stuff. Like I could feel it from the inside almost.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, a lot of this is just breath awareness. And we breathe unconsciously all the time. But if we just... groundedness is inherently just being aware of the breath, because it's something we do unconsciously so much. Anyone else? Yeah.
Feeling my body, feeling my experience without judgment of it needing to be anything.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, especially when you have someone just saying things to you, like you, also your interpretation of, for example, drawing a string from the top of your head all the way down your body is probably very different than mine. Sometimes I use different kind of words or qualifications to go through that experience, but it's all just corporal awareness, and it's all just anything that you can do to think about your body and what is happening right now. So thanks for sharing. Anyone else? Yeah.
I have another side of the coin.
Okay.
Last time I tried doing this, I was outside, and all I felt was frustration because I was trying to focus, and I was hearing traffic, and I was hearing, you know, angry people honking their horns and all this, and I feel like I never really got what I wanted out of it. So do you feel like there's times that also it's sort of like a failure to meditate?
What do you want to get out of meditation? Do you feel like there's any kind of effort that is associated with relaxation?
Well, I suppose there has to be, right? I mean, because you have to say that you really want to be relaxed.
I guess so. I mean, I think there's, you know, the things that you were mentioning, traffic and things, I think those are things that can just ground us even further, for example. You know, if I'm driving, that is oftentimes one of the most, this is almost crazy to say because I have days when this is not the case, but that's almost one of the most mindful exercises that we can do. Because for example, when you hear someone's horn, you can think about that and then just bring yourself back to the road. That's why my dad's a trucker. So I can drive long distances and not get frustrated. And it's a very relaxing experience for me. I know. Good for you. Thanks, man. But thinking about how, you know, a highway is structured and there's these signs every couple of miles or every mile, and then just looking at that sign and looking away, I think the this idea of going to something and then coming back to the breath, instead of thinking, oh, I'm frustrated that I'm not relaxed right now, that might be just a better way to start that. When we're frustrated with not being relaxed, I think that just pushes us further into this idea of not being relaxed. So sort of what you're saying. But yeah, this is sort of goes along also with what I was saying about that meditation in many ways is kind of this social construct that involves us sitting in a room quietly and just trying really hard not to think about anything. A lot of this too, in meditation, I believe firmly to be this muscle that needs to be exercised. And starting with, you know, if 120 seconds was too much and you didn't get anything out of that, start with 60 seconds or 30 seconds or 20 seconds. There's a lot of parallels to this in music. I mean, you know, you don't start by playing a whole Bordoni etude as soon as you start playing the tuba or the euphonium. You maybe start with long tones, or you start with half the etude, and making something more manageable, it might be a better pathway to get to what we want. Does any of that resonate? Yeah, just starting smaller. I mean, also with physical exercise too, like we're not going to start by running a mile. We're going to start by running maybe a tenth of a mile. Otherwise, we'll just die on the side of the road. good. Okay. Well, thank you for sharing, guys. Just going to move through this for the sake of time. Oh, okay. The first idea, and this is sort of step one on the hotline, is this idea of just pressing pause. And that is literally exactly what we just did. So just taking a few seconds to assess whatever is making you tense. I always start this process with four sets of four inhales and four exhales. So you're doing 32 breaths, math. And when you're done that, then you ask yourself the question, what is going on? And oftentimes we can get to the core of what is bothering us. I think, you know, if you can get there even quicker without the breath, but the breath is just a way to physically relax us so that that question is easily answerable. But the idea that just we are so close to actually understanding a little bit more about what is bothering us, that we can just ask ourselves that question, and our gut or mind or heart can tell us that very quickly. You know, if something's bothering me, asking myself this question, it's like, oh yeah, that does suck. And just saying that oftentimes just alleviates a lot of tension or pressure around that particular feeling. This idea of counting backwards by threes from 100, if any of you have trouble with insomnia, this is brilliant. My conception of it is just that it's complex enough to give ourselves something to think about, but simple enough to sort of lull ourselves into a sense of sleep. And if you count by twos, it's very systematic, but if you count by fours, also systematic, by threes sort of changes. I mean, I'm not good at math, so it's a little complex for me. And again, this just helps reduce any kind of mental chatter that we have around something that is bothering us. So whatever you can do to get yourself to a point of having a clear head to target this thing that is bothering you is really the way that we want to go with this. Grounding technique, something that we do also all the time, something that I do all the time, something that is also very relevant with regards to performance anxiety, if any of you struggle with this. So this idea that connecting ourselves with physical things around the room makes us think about what is happening right now. This is really relevant in an audition situation. I do this every time I walk on stage, especially in an audition where the space you're playing in is likely an unfamiliar space. So even, you know, if I was walking out here, I would walk to my chair and then just start to connect myself with things in the room. What color are the chairs? How many chairs are in the front row? How many steps are there? What color is my seat? And just running through these things. I mean, this idea, five things, four things, we can do this really quickly. Wes, I'm picking on you again. Five things you can see in the room right now. Four things you can feel. Your glasses, your shirt, a couple other things. Kevin, three things you can hear. Yes. Two things you can smell. Nice. And one thing you can taste. Very honest. I appreciate that. So this is a silly exercise, but doing it by yourself, especially when you're in a tense moment, is just one of those things that you can do to get yourself more to a point of focus and calm. And again, especially with regards to performance anxiety, just one of those things that really connects us with the room that we're in. So often we walk out on stage and it's just tunnel vision focus, and we're just looking at the music stand and trying not to make eye contact with anyone on stage. But opening yourself up to your surroundings and making eye contact with people will sort of break that barrier down, and I believe to make things a little bit easier. Personal crisis toolkit, this is sort of something that I've constructed myself as part of this presentation, but this idea that there are, sort of as I talked about before, there are self-care things that I do that I know that I can do when I get to a point of requiring self-care, that I believe that it requires less energy to do those things if I know what those things are before I get to that point. So this is an awareness piece. I mean, there are likely things that all of us know that bring ourselves to a point of calm more than other things. And this is great, especially with regards to, you know, if you have a stressful day, the easiest thing sometimes is to turn to a vice, whether it be, you know, you can eat or drink alcohol or do drugs. And these are easy ways to relieve stress because they're oftentimes accessible to us if we have the means to do so. But sometimes going for a walk is, of course, much more difficult than pouring ourselves a drink. And I think those things, just having those things lined up, of course, are healthier ways to target stress and more sustainable ways to target stress as well. The idea also that you can talk yourself down from a particular situation by asking yourself, what is the worst that can happen? Again, something very relevant with regards to performance anxiety. So if any of you have a recital coming up, what is the worst thing if I miss the high B flat in Symphony Fantastique? Somebody notices? I mean, you don't die. So this, of course, works for particular people, but sometimes, I mean, somebody might be like, well, I'll fail my Dury and I'll lose everything. It's like, no, that's not going to happen. So it really works for particular logic-minded individuals. So teachers out there, of course, just think about when you're using this tool, because sometimes it can make things worse for some people, speaking from experience. This idea also at the end of reframing the voice inside of our head, this is something that is very prevalent in the music world. Of course, oftentimes when we're performing, we have this voice inside of our head that's saying, you're going to miss the high B flat in Symphony Fantastique. And how many times did we miss the high B flat in Symphony Fantastique after that voice has spoken? In this book, The Untethered Soul by Michael A. Singer, great book. He talks about how if we assign a persona to that voice inside of our head, it takes the power away from it. So when this voice is talking to us, it feels like this kind of ubiquitous, all-knowing force that knows everything. But that's simply not true. It's literally just a voice inside of our head. So in this way, I think assigning a persona that is sort of, you know, in jest, for example, I use my roommate. So my roommate's the one who's telling me I'm going to miss the high B flat in Symphony Fantastique. And what does my roommate know? He doesn't even play tuba. So, see, we're all laughing. It's not serious anymore. And then the last point before I take some questions is just this idea that we all have a support system out there. And this idea that there's a lot of people out there that I talk to who often say something along the lines of, well, when somebody talks to me, I don't know what to say, or I'm not good at talking to people, I just don't know how to listen. Again, like many things, listening is a muscle that needs to be exercised. And if we listen to others how we want to be listened to, or we treat others how we want to be treated, that takes a lot of the kind of stress away from listening to somebody. So many times, especially in my younger years, I feel like when somebody was opening up to me about something, I would feel so much responsibility to try to fix their problems, especially if it was a student or if I had gone down that path. And I mean, if you were in that situation, would you want someone to tell you how to do something, or would you want someone to just listen to you? And this is really kind of my biggest point, is that I think many of us are not aware of the support system that we have. And you all have friends, family members, colleagues who likely would drop everything to support you if you ever needed anything. And a big part of this, and just being a good support system for others, is the idea of active listening, a term that gets thrown around a lot, but I think very few people actually define. So when we're listening actively, we're listening with the intent of fully understanding and comprehending what someone says when they're speaking to us. So a few points: just don't get distracted, try not to interrupt them, use door openers like "go on, that's interesting," paraphrase, so say, you know, if someone says, "I'm having a tough day," don't say, "sounds like you're having a tough day." That doesn't sound good. Say something more like, "sounds like you're going through a tough time. Tell me more about that." And it has just a little bit more weight and understanding behind it. And then again, taking responsibility out of this idea that sometimes silence is better than saying anything. And if you don't say anything, if someone's opening up to you, oftentimes they will just keep talking about what's bothering. And it takes a lot of the responsibility away from you to prescribe a solution to them, and allows them the space to open up about things that are bothering them. So that's how you listen to people. And I need to read this sometimes too. By no means am I a perfect listener, but just reminding ourselves that we can be the person that we would need sometimes in a dark period is important. So all that to say, I by no means am an expert about mental health. I'm not a psychiatrist. I'm not a psychologist. But I have experience with these things, and I've been trained to offer these tools to people in need. And if anyone you know or you are ever in any kind of hardship or difficult time, there are tools at your disposal and there are resources at your disposal. And if you would like to continue this conversation further, that is my email. I'm always happy to talk about this stuff. Any questions? I'll be around for the rest of the day if anyone wants to talk individually as well. Questions? Thank you very much, guys. Appreciate it. We'll be right back.
We've got a great concert lined up for you. There's also a fantastic concert tonight. The Army Orchestra and several wonderful soloists are going to be playing, so please make it out to that. Our next concert is the George Mason Tuba and Euphonium Ensemble, and that's run by Dr. David Porter and Dr. Mark Jenkins. And to start off this program, it's a Dr. Porter is going to be soloing on the first movement of the Anthony O'Toole Tuba Concerto, and it's a pretty new work that Dr. Porter actually commissioned. So would you guys please help me and welcome Dr. David Porter.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So next on our program, it's nice in the group of such talented students that we can branch off into little groups too. So this is a chamber group that these folks put together with themselves and playing for about a couple of years. And they're now called the Fairfax Four. And they're going to be playing a couple of tunes for you, you'll see in your program.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. And now we're going to introduce the full group from our school. It's the George Mason University Tuba-Euphonium Ensemble. Been around for about 15 years and gone to a number of regional and international performances. We try to travel almost every year if we can. So this group's marvelous to work with, and we have a lot of fun, meet once a week, and have a great time. So you're going to hear a couple of pieces you've heard before that are real great standards. Dr. Jenkins, our co-director, is going to do. Then a couple of students are going to conduct a piece, because we try to share the podium with all of our students eventually to give them some experience. Finish off with two brand new pieces. They have been premiered already last fall, but you haven't heard them. They were somewhere else. And a new composer named Tyler Meir at our school wrote them for us, so it's nice to have some new literature. So without further ado, here's Dr. Jenkins and the Tuba-Euphonium Ensemble from George Mason.
Thank you.
So again, thanks for being with us this afternoon. Our last two pieces by Tyler Meir, new compositions. And I also want to add that if any of you out there are interested in coming to George Mason or think of it as a place for you to be to get your music degree, please come talk to us. We have a lot of programs. You know, George Mason University is the largest university in Virginia now, and our music department is definitely growing by leaps and bounds. So here they are, and thank you again for coming.
Thank you. Thank you. 30 in the morning. I would go to bed.